Well, there's still the Iron Bowl to be played, but year one for Kalen DeBoer in Tuscaloosa, a failure.
You are Locked On College Football with Spencer McLaughlin, your daily podcast on all things college football, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Welcome, everybody, to another episode of Locked On College Football. I'm your host, Spencer McLaughlin. Thank you so much for making this your first listen or your first view every day. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day and your daily source to stay up to date with this, the greatest sport on planet Earth. This episode brought to you by our friends at FanDuel, where you can get a big return. New customers can place a $5 bet and you'll get $150 in bonus bets. If you win your first $5 bet, visit FanDuel.com to get started. Lots to get to. Texas at Texas A&M is going to live up to the hype. And then some because of what happened this weekend. And I'm going to try to make sense of the Big 12 for you. I don't know if I'm going to succeed, but I'm going to try. Try not. Do or do not. Somebody said that. I don't remember who it was. Anyway, so I think it's a good line. Alabama hired Kalen DeBoer. He has tried in his first year. He has failed. There is no other way to describe this. When Kalen DeBoer got hired at Alabama, I remember what I said on this very show. It was, in fact, the very first episode of Locked On College Football. My take was Kalen DeBoer can win national championships at Alabama. And guess what? He still can. I tend to think that given time, he will. That time isn't right now. So if you're just discussing Kalen DeBoer, not the recruiting success that Alabama's having in the 2025 cycle, not what he can be, not what could have been. If you're just looking at how this season has gone, it is an abject failure for Alabama because they should be out of the college football playoff discussion. That should not exist. I don't want to hear from anyone. I don't want to even see it. I don't even want to know that anyone has the opinion that a three-loss SEC team should get into the college football playoff. Don't want to hear it. They should not get there. Do not deserve it. Especially after they just went to Norman and got embarrassed. That was an embarrassing performance. Kalen DeBoer, an offensive guy, puts up less than 300 yards against an Oklahoma team that hadn't beaten an FBS opponent since September? Sure, their defense is capable. Was it that capable? That was game 11. Why did Jalen Milroe look like it was his first time playing in a new offense? I have several other questions about Alabama. They have things to work on in the offseason. They need to figure out how to play better defense. 250 rushing yards to Oklahoma? Jackson Arnold went for 68 yards passing. Why was that a loss? I haven't seen a stat line like that since Michigan beat USC earlier this year in what was at the time a big game. And as the season has gone on, not quite as important, but it was fun at the time. And Alex Orji had 32 passing yards. Michigan won the game. That should not happen in the Power Four ranks. So the defensive staff, they've got things to work on. The offensive line isn't good. I hope I'm not breaking news to Alabama fans here, but it's probably a surprise to those who haven't watched every Alabama game this season. The offensive line isn't good. Brent Venables clowned the Alabama offensive line because the players that he's got up front, guys like Dominic Williams and the like, and Danny Stutzman, a linebacker, the blitzes they were coming with, Jalen Milroe was under duress all night. And he threw three interceptions. I mean, that was not an acceptable performance for the Crimson Tide. I think Alabama fans are going to agree with me. Maybe you don't. You let me know. But when I said and stand by the idea that Kalen DeBoer can win national championships, plural, at Alabama, I know that he's a great coach. I know he's got everything he needs to succeed in Tuscaloosa. This season, though, is a failure because they're not going to make the playoff. And they shouldn't make the playoff. And that's the standard in the 12-team era. If this were the 4-team playoff and Alabama didn't make it in his first year, I wouldn't automatically say it's a failure. But in the 12-team era, I know that Kalen DeBoer isn't Nick Saban. I know there was some roster turnover. But you can't look at that Alabama roster after everything they did in the transfer portal, the high school classes that Nick Saban left him. I know not everybody stuck around. They weren't all there. But was that a well-stocked cupboard compared to what some other coaches have taken over? What do you think Indiana has done this season? Yeah, they lost this week to Ohio State. Okay. But do you think Kurt Cignetti got the most out of that roster? Absolutely. Do you think Kalen DeBoer got the most out of this Alabama roster this season? Absolutely, positively not. Jalen Milroe somehow seemed like he was regressing throughout the course of the year. And one question that I asked in the offseason that I thought was answered early in the year, but it's becoming clear really isn't yet, is how would these two guys mesh? How would a Kalen DeBoer offense and Jalen Milroe's playstyle go together? They look like oil and water. They're not meshing. They're not mixing. Some solvent needs to come through. Maybe it's the offseason, but don't be surprised if after this year, Jalen Milroe hits the transfer portal. Don't be surprised. I'm not saying that with any intel or insight. I'm just telling you what I think. It doesn't look like a perfect fit. Milroe is a guy who moves around and runs around a lot, and it looked like they'd found that formula against LSU. But it turns out they can't throw the football. And Kalen DeBoer wants a guy that sits in the pocket and slices and dices. That's what his offense has always been. Jay Kaner at Fresno State, Penix at Indiana, Penix at Washington. Bet if you went back and looked at his Sioux Falls coaching tenure at the NAIA ranks, he would have had a lot of success throwing the football. Well, Jalen Milroe does not look comfortable. He does not look like he's completely settled into the offense. I don't think it's all the way on Jalen Milroe. As I said, the offensive line isn't any good. But there are several metrics that Alabama has to fix here. But this roster has not even come close to being maximized. Vegas didn't favor them by over 20 points at Vandy and two touchdowns at Oklahoma by accident. They know that if Alabama was playing to its potential, they'd win by that many points or more. But they're not. But they're not. And I know it's year one. I know it's a transition year. But this isn't a transition year at Purdue. This isn't a transition year at Duke. This is a transition year at the University of Alabama in the 12-team playoff where 10-2 gets you in with the schedule that Bama has. That should have been more than feasible to obtain. And obviously, they're not going to get there. And Auburn picked up a big emotional win against Texas A&M, and Alabama plays the Iron Bowl this week at home. I imagine Bama will come out motivated to show the committee that they should be in the college football playoff. Nonsense. Absolute, complete, and utter nonsense. That is not a good Oklahoma team. I don't think Alabama, based on their resume, should be ranked inside the top 15. That loss, not just that it happened, but in the way that it happened, that should drop Alabama completely out. Ole Miss, three losses, one of them to Kentucky, another to unranked Florida, you're done. You're done. Texas A&M, third loss, well, they could still backdoor their way in if they make the SEC championship game. I'll talk about that more later. But this was a failure of a first season for Alabama. There's plenty of work to be done. It can be accomplished. But these are real issues that have plagued Alabama throughout the course of the season, and Kalen DeBoer and his staff have to go to the drawing board and get them right. They got to fix the offensive line. I think that's priority number one. And they've got to figure out how to be better on defense number two. And number three will come with number one. They need to get back to being able to run the football. I don't think Alabama is short on running back talent, but I feel like they are completely hidden, lost, misused, vanished in this Alabama offense. That shouldn't be the case. So there are plenty of things to fix. But this season, in my book, over for Alabama. Was not a good year. Failure of a season. But that's why he signed a contract to coach for more than 1 year. Things can improve. I'd even suspect that they will. But they are not going to get better this season. Alabama won't be in the college football playoff. I didn't have that on my bingo card. How many SEC teams are getting in? Well, that discussion is going to come up in the next segment. Do you realize Texas and Texas A&M haven't met in 13 years? That's a baker's dozen. That's just far too long for two fan bases that have spent the last 13 years rooting against one another despite not meeting on the field. I want you to hype this matchup in your head. I want you to be excited at the prospect of watching these teams play on the same field this Saturday in College Station. And I'm telling you, it's going to meet your expectations or surpass them. That's coming up next. Coming up right now is FanDuel. Get ready to tackle the NFL action with FanDuel, America's number one sportsbook. Right now, new customers can bet $5 and get $150 in bonus bets if you win. The FanDuel Sportsbook app gives you everything you need to place live bets on the NFL all in one place. So when you get a hunch in the middle of the game, you can check out the latest stats, view live play-by-play, and so much more on the same page where you place your bets. Just visit FanDuel.com to join today. It's rivalry week. Do you want to bet rivalry games? FanDuel.com is the place to do it. FanDuel's got all the action. They've got Michigan favored by 20, Oregon favored by 19.5, Texas A&M, 5.5-point home underdogs. You do whatever you like. You'll get 150 in bonus bets if you win your first $5 bet at FanDuel.com. You do what, like Ted Lasso, you do whatever you like. Never waste a hunch. Make every moment more with FanDuel, an official sportsbook partner of the NFL. This might be the game I'm most excited for this week. Texas at Texas A&M. Longhorns favored by 5.5. You make whatever decision you like. I just tell you FanDuel.com is a place to make your wager at if you are so inclined. But when I think about this matchup, can you give me another game that would have these sorts of stakes, that would have this sort of negative passion? What I mean by that is not so much Texas wanting Texas to succeed and Texas A&M wanting Texas A&M to succeed. I get the sense between these two fan bases that they root against the other as much, or for some, perhaps even more over the years as they root for their own team. I guarantee you, every single fan that is going to show up and be a part of the 12th man at Kyle Field on Saturday, last year in the college football playoff semifinal, was saying, go Dogs, we love the Huskies, hum Washington, go Kalen DeBoer. Guarantee it. Guarantee that we're all doing it. It's not, I'm not going to think about them. No, yeah, both programs think about each other a lot. The vitriol that can take place between these programs is incredible. 13 years it has been, too long. Far, far too long since these teams have met on the football field. This is one of the aspects of realignment I am on board with. Texas and Texas A&M playing every year. You didn't have to whittle down the Big 12 to what it is. More on that conference coming up later in today's show, because boy, it's a chaotic nightmare, isn't the word, because it's a nightmare for some to navigate. But for me, it's just give me the popcorn. I'm going to sit here and watch all these tiebreaker scenarios perhaps play out, or maybe not, depending on how things go on Saturday. But the Big 12 should never have lost Texas and Oklahoma. They belong in there. And Oklahoma fans might be having buyer's remorse right about now. Maybe not in the future. I mean, they did just beat Alabama, I'm aware. They're still 6-5. They're 2-5 in conference play. Was that ever feasible in the Big 12? No, that's not really how it went. But that's not the point that I'm trying to make here. The point I'm trying to make is that just because I don't like something, such as the 12-team playoff or realignment, and I disagree with them as to how they're going to influence college football, doesn't mean there can't be positive elements to it. If you make me a dish of food and you make me a lovely cut of ribeye and you served with it garlic whipped mashed potatoes and grilled asparagus, if you undercook the meat or overcook the meat, that's going to ruin the dish a little bit. That doesn't mean I'm not going to eat all of the mashed potatoes and asparagus if they're cooked and seasoned properly. I'm still going to enjoy them. So Texas and Texas A&M might be my favorite aspect of realignment. These teams should play every single year because this can become a truly great rivalry, and it's all going to be on display this week. So Texas A&M picks up its third loss in a 4-overtime thriller at Jordan-Hare. And as Nick Saban said on College Game Day, that place is just cursed. There's just something about it. Well, Texas A&M learned, as if they didn't already know, what it was all about. And what it's about is, we're going to win a football game whether you think we should or not. Well, I had a last second flip on this pick, and Texas A&M ends up losing the game. And I picked Auburn to win, and Auburn goes out and wins. You can look at this one of two ways. If you were in the SEC homerism camp, of which I do not subscribe myself, some people can lobby said accusation, but I don't know where that comes from, quite frankly. If you're in the SEC homerism camp, look at the depth of the SEC. Or if you're in the more reasonable camp, this is the one that I am in, it's, hey, the SEC has a bunch of good teams, but they don't have a lot of great teams. There's just a lot of good. It's okay. I'm not telling you the SEC is a bad conference. I'm telling you that Auburn beating Texas A&M is a reflection that Texas A&M was never great, rather than, well, Auburn was just good. No, I've watched Auburn play a lot of football this year. They're not good. They're not a good football team. They can be a good program under Hugh Freeze, but they are not a good football team in the year 2024. So Texas A&M loses that game, but still, because one of their losses is to Notre Dame week one at home, who looked really good again. They won and covered against Army. I suspected they would. Texas A&M, this is not an outright lose sort of vibe following the loss against Auburn. Why? They can still get in the SEC championship game. All they have to do is beat Texas. And the stakes in this game are what are going to help elevate this rivalry and just catapult it into the future. Because the stakes here are huge. They're huge. The loser of this game could very well be out of the playoff. Texas A&M will be. Texas A&M cannot make the playoff unless they win this football game. Texas, on the other hand, just think about it. If they lose to Texas A&M and they end the season 10-2, they're not going to the SEC championship game. They're probably in the playoff. But remember that resume conversation that we were having about Indiana? That same sort of conversation should absolutely apply to Texas if they don't win this football game. I know it's on the road, hostile environment, good team. Not a great one, but a good team in Texas A&M. Texas should absolutely be looked at as a team capable of missing the playoff if they don't win this game. Now, that is dependent upon a lot of other factors. It's rivalry week. Things are going to get crazy. They haven't been normal the entire college football season. I don't know why you would think that is suddenly going to start this week when you've got an abundant number of rivalries across the country. So if it plays out this way or that way, yeah, Texas could still get into the playoff. But when I look at their schedule and what the SEC has actually been this year, not the perception of it, though I think that is starting to shift in some particular college football circles, a 10-2 Texas, to me, should not get into the playoff over, just as an example, an 11-2 BYU. Well, they'd be a conference champion at that point since they lost, but let's see if I can come up with it. How about this? Loser of the ACC championship game should get in over Texas. There. I said it. Miami, SMU, go look at their schedules. Who is SMU's only loss to? Oh, that's right. It's by 3 points to a top 20 team in BYU, who, yes, lost again this week. I thought they would. Why? Because Arizona State's a better overall football team. Arizona State, I'll talk about them a little bit more later on today's show. But SMU has handled business. Well, Texas has only lost the two games this year against teams that are ranked. So they have no quality wins. Hope you're not punishing Indiana too much in your mind for that and then wanting to reward Texas on the same front. So at the very least, Texas A&M can keep their own playoff hopes alive and make Texas's playoff future uncertain, while Texas could lock up a spot in the SEC championship game and completely knock Texas A&M out of the title game and therefore the playoff discussion, as they would end the season eight and four. The stakes on this game are awesome. They're just phenomenally good. I said going into this, I hope both teams win out until that particular point. I almost kind of like this one more, where there is some finality to Texas A&M losing, and they're 100% done. Texas is a 5.5-point road favorite. You make of that whatever you like. I believe it opened at Texas -7.5. Vegas trying to tell you they think the Longhorns are a better team. Quinn Ewers reportedly had an MRI on his ankle. He's expected to be okay. What if he goes down in this game? Can you imagine this rivalry being renewed with Arch Manning running the show for the Longhorns? That's a television spectacle that every network and programming director across the country that controls a lot of college football, whether you like it or not, they're salivating over that notion. I'm not saying they're rooting for Quinn Ewers to get hurt. I'm just saying if he does go down, they're going to get excited, and they get to talk about Arch Manning. And the opportunity at that point for Arch to catapult himself into the national conversation going into 2025 would be some pretty sweet optics. It would be something to behold. So this game is going to have all the makings of a rivalry renewed that gets launched into a matchup people will demand to see every single year, that they should want to see every single year. And with playoff implications going both way on the line, I don't know how much more fun it could be. Can't wait. Let me know your thoughts in YouTube comments or hit me up on X, formerly known as Twitter, at SMcLaughlinCFB. That's the handle, or at LockedOn_CFB. Let's try and make sense of the Big 12. I say try, because I don't know if we can. I really don't. It's coming up next. After we talk about Game Time, which has this great feature, it's called Game Time Picks, that makes getting tickets to see your favorite teams play live even easier. Game Time Picks filters out the fluff to show you only incredible deals on great seats, so you don't have to waste time searching through thousands of tickets. Curation makes it easier to save more on sports, concerts, comedy, theater, whatever you're looking for, and Game Time gives you a panoramic view in the app from your seat before you buy, so you know exactly what to expect. Take the guesswork out of buying tickets with Game Time Picks. Download the Game Time app, create an account, use code LOCKEDONCOLLEGE for $20 off your first purchase. Terms apply. Again, create an account. Redeem code LOCKEDONCOLLEGE at Game Time for $20 off. Download Game Time today. What time is it? Game Time. The good old Big 12. For a moment there, it looked like the SEC was going to overtake the Big 12 as this is the most interesting conference title race. Nope. The SEC is fascinating. The SEC's got big stakes going into rivalry week. Georgia has secured their spot in the SEC title game. Nobody else has. Oregon has secured their spot in the Big Ten championship game. Ohio State just has to beat Michigan. They're going to beat Michigan. SMU has secured its spot in the ACC championship game. They'll play Miami if the Hurricanes win, or Clemson if the Hurricanes lose. I suspect that'll be Miami. Do you know who's locked their spot up in the Big 12 championship game? Zero teams, nobody, not a single solitary team has locked this thing up. As many as 9 teams. I need you to hear me and hear me clearly and understand that this has been reported, researched, documented, and I have never seen anything like this before. As many as 9 teams can win the Big 12 championship going into the last week of the regular season. I mean, I've brought this line up before, but it bears repeating. This is Tom Haverford in Parks and Recreation. He's looking, I don't even remember what he's looking at. He's just looking at a still frame photo, and he says, "It's beautiful. I've been staring at this for 5 hours now. This is the Big 12. This is the most entertaining conference title race I can possibly remember. There was the spectacle." Is that what we're going to call it? Sure, why not? At Mountain America Stadium, which is where Arizona State plays. Tempe had a crazy scene, a storming of the field, a cursing out of officials. And then the students left, and then a Hail Mary was caught at the 3-yard line, and Arizona State won anyway. And Kenny Dillingham might be the most likable coach in college football. And I have been told on a couple occasions that he and I have a similar appearance to one another, and I'm not going to comment on that. On an unrelated note, Kenny Dillingham might be the sharpest looking coach in all of college football. So he's 34 years old. His passion for Arizona State University cannot be understated. If you have never seen this guy talk in front of a microphone when he is asked a question about leading the Sun Devil football program, every single fan base in the country should aspire to have a guy that cares as much as he does. Few do, but he loves it there. And that's not just a football program, but an athletic department that was not run well for a long time. And he understands his importance as the football coach of revitalizing everything down there. They're trying to activate the Valley. Consider them activated. I saw him on the field on Saturday afternoon because they beat BYU. So, Arizona State and Iowa State control their own destiny here. That's it. That is it. BYU, Colorado, in the mix. West Virginia, Baylor, Texas Tech. These are all teams that through crazy tiebreakers could find themselves in the Big 12 championship game. This is going to be the most phenomenally awesome Saturday, but confusing that I can remember. A couple of good people to follow. Ross Dellinger does a good job. Nicola Auerbach of the Athletic does a good job. Pretty sure she's still at the Athletic. Heather Danich of ESPN. They lay out Brett McMurphy, the Action Network, as well. If you're looking for follows on Twitter that will keep you updated with tiebreakers and lay things out very clearly and concisely, those people are excellent ones to follow. Because this stuff can get very confusing. And they all had different layouts about all the different scenarios and how the tiebreakers work and whatnot. If Arizona State beats Arizona, not a guarantee. Not a guarantee. I'll explain why in just a moment. If Arizona State beats Arizona, and if Iowa State wins as well, they will play in the Big 12 championship game. If you have a four-way tie, which is what you currently have, Colorado, BYU, Iowa State, Arizona State, they're all sitting there at 6-2. If that four-way tie remains, then it is Iowa State and it is Arizona State for the Big 12 championship and the right to go to the college football playoff. Iowa State, not a surprise. Their preseason win total was 7.5. I had them going over. Here they are. Arizona State, I had them going over their preseason total of 4.5. I didn't see this. I did not see this. Which brings me to the duel in the desert this week. We'll talk about the game matchup as this week progresses, but here's something that you should know. Arizona stinks. Even more than I thought they. I thought they were a bowl team. I thought a great quarterback and wide receiver could get you to a bowl game, but the quarterback part of that has been missing for the Wildcats. It hasn't gone well for Brent Brennan and company. So they're missing a bowl game after TCU beat them in Fort Worth this past week. The motivation level for Arizona in this game is going to be higher in this matchup than it has for any other game this season. I don't care what anybody in that locker room says. Heck, they might even tell it to you outright. Because not only is Arizona not even close to where their preseason goals and aspirations were, they're not even playing another game after this one. This is their Super Bowl. So if you're Arizona State, you better come out ready to go. You better avoid the emotional letdown factor after winning one of the biggest games in Tempe in the last 15 to 20 years. You better come out ready, because I guarantee you, mentally, Arizona wants nothing more. There's nothing else to play for. And that's a dangerous football team. That is a dang. I don't care what the logo is, what the teams are, the conferences. You give me a rivalry where one side has nothing left to lose, they're going to throw the kitchen sink at Arizona State to win this game. I bet they'll be ready with a fake field goal if they get a good look, a fake punt. They'll go for it on fourth down. They will do anything to win the game. Because this could save the perception of Brent Brennan and that staff who have had a rough go of it in the first year. And playing spoiler for the team they share a state with, whose rivalry is one of the most underrated in all of college football, that's not going to be an easy thing to do. Not going to be an easy thing to do. But Iowa State, they won. What can you say? They won. Utah was on like their 18th quarterback of the season. Not actually. They were on like their sixth. That's serious. They got down to their sixth quarterback. And Iowa State found a way to win. They've been stumbling to the finish line here, Iowa State. But they're still here. They fell off after those two straight losses, but they found a way. They found a way to go to Rice-Eccles and win. Not an easy thing to do. Not an easy thing to do. So they'll get an opportunity to go to the Big 12 championship game. And boy, I couldn't love this conference anymore right now, because I thought it'd be fun. I thought it'd be exciting. I thought it would be great. And it's even better. It's legitimately even better than I thought it would be. And I don't know how you got to that point, but we're absolutely there. We're absolutely there. By the way, Colorado is going to win. They play Oklahoma State. They need help. They need help. But help is often given to those in college football who hold their own. And Colorado will have a chance to bounce back, hold their own, and get to 9-3 this season, which, by the way, is still a successful year. If Colorado doesn't appear in the Big 12 title game or the college football playoff or anywhere close to it, and they just go to a good bowl game, number one, it'll be the most watched version of that bowl probably ever. And number two, this is undoubtedly a successful season for Deion Sanders and company. And remember, they got Juju Lewis. Remember, former five-star quarterback committed to USC. Yep, USC flipped somebody else. Bryce Underwood flipped from LSU to Michigan. And Juju Lewis flipped from USC to Colorado. If you were looking for an indicator that Deion Sanders is going to stick around in the Big 12 for a while, Juju Lewis would be the guy. He has got megastar potential. Not every high school quarterback prodigy works out that way. But Juju Lewis can certainly be the next great quarterback at Colorado. That was a huge, huge commitment. I might talk about that more later this week. But the wild, wacky, and wonderful Big 12 is going to give you a rivalry week unlike any other. And 9 teams are still alive. You could have an 8-way tiebreaker in this conference. I'm grinning ear to ear for those listening on podcasts, just being able to say that. But alas, we can. I hope it never changes. Appreciate everyone listening. I'll see you next time. And until then, hope you have a wonderful rest of your day.